Good morning. Happy New Year. Let's all stand together. We'll sing hymn number 296. 296. We'll sing hymn number 511. 511.
Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? Faintly now I see him.
Have your Bibles with you this morning. If you would, open up with me to the book of Psalms. I'd like to read Psalm 100. Psalm 100. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he God. He hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let's have a word of prayer. Our most high and heavenly precious Father, Lord God Almighty, we bow before you once more this morning. We want to bow before you in thanksgiving. We want to praise your holy name. Lord, we're so thankful for such a blessed gospel, for such a salvation in our Lord Jesus Christ. Free, pure, rich, and unboundless. For each of your sheep. Lord, we thank you for this new year, this new day in this new year. Lord, as we sung praises to your name just moments ago, all the way you have led us and all the way you will lead us till we get to meet you face to face. We pray that you would continue to keep us
lead us and guide us this year. It's my hope and prayer, Lord, that you will cause the gospel to be proclaimed here, as well in all of the buildings where your saints gather. Have your word to be preached freely and boldly. Lord, have mercy on your people, wherever they may be. We ask for the sick among us, those who are not with us. Lord, be our strength and our stay. Be our all in all. Let us not to look to this world for what we think we might need, Lord. We know that all of our need, all of our supplication is in thee. Lord, let us not forget. I ask that you would cause us to grow in faith. Give us grace. Cause our love to grow for one another and for our Savior. That you would teach us our way, teach us your way, and keep us from this world. Lord, we ask that you would meet with us this morning. Be with our brother as he stands before us. Give him the words to speak freely to us. We ask for blessings through him, Lord, and that you would bless him. We pray that thy will be done, Lord, for Christ's sake, to your honor and to thy glory. We ask these things in his name. Amen. Hymn number 355 in our hymnals. 355.
Thank you.
Stand together and sing the hymn of the day in the bulletin. Blessed to have Brother Aaron Greenleaf with us once again. It's been a pleasure to have you. I feel like we've had you more in the last few months than we have in the last few years, and I'm glad for it. It's good to get to see you and hear you proclaim the gospel. So you come and bring us what you have prepared.
Hit the red button when you're ready.
Yes, sir. Morning, everybody. It's good to see you all again. If you'd like, turn over to 2 Peter chapter 1. As always, bring with me all the well wishes, good thoughts from everybody in Lexington. Everybody told me to tell you hi, so be good to my word. Tell y'all hi for them. Hope everybody enjoyed their holidays, Christmas. Today is January 1, 2023. This is New Year's Day, start of a brand new year. And this is the time where everybody makes New Year's resolutions, right? I was talking to my wife about this the other day. I don't know that I've never made a New Year's resolution. I don't know that I've ever actually done it. And it's probably for a good reason. I know myself just enough to know that I wouldn't keep it anyways, so it's just better off that way. But many of you may. You may have some New Year's resolutions. New year, clean slate. We're going to do something new. We're going to get in the gym more, save some more money, spend more time with family, whatever it may be. Those are all good things. This is the scripture I thought of, though. What is to be sought? Diligently, what goal should be pursued? Look down at verse 10, 2 Peter chapter 1. Peter says, "Wherefore the rather, the first, brethren, give diligence. Make this your aim. Put your heart into this. To make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall, for so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." Now, there was a time where I would read that. Diligently, make your calling and election sure, and I would stumble at that verse. It would give me a whole lot of trouble. How do I do that? What am I being commanded to do here? Make your calling and election sure, and be diligent about this. Make this your aim. How do I do that? What do you mean by that? Isn't it already? What have I missed along the way? Is there something I'm missing? Or worse yet, is this something that's to be earned? Because that's how the world would describe it. Make your calling and election sure. If you do the thing you're supposed to do, God will choose you. He'll elect you. And after that, he'll give you a calling. He'll offer you this invitation. And you can either accept the invitation or you can reject it. Salvation by works all day long. What does this mean? Make your calling and election sure. Is this something to be earned? Is there something I'm supposed to do here? Absolutely not. I think it's interesting, two words are used here. Make your calling and your election sure. And the hallmark of both those things, they have absolutely nothing to do with us. We have absolutely no influence over those things. These are the things of God, and they display the sovereignty of God and salvation so powerfully. Let's deal with those two things for a moment, your calling and your election. Let's deal with election first. Turn over to Romans chapter 9. Now, most of you are probably very familiar with this chapter. Paul uses this chapter to expound on the sovereignty of God and salvation, probably more here than anywhere else in Scripture. But in here, he's going to talk about election. He's going to give an illustration of it. And he uses two boys, two brothers, Jacob and Esau. That's his illustration, the children of Rebekah and Isaac. Look at what he says in verse 10. He says, "And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac." Listen, considering these boys, Jacob and Esau, "for the children, these two boys, being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand of what? Not of works. But of him that calleth, it was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated." Now my question is this, when and why? When? God loved one of these boys. He loved a boy named Jacob. And he chose Jacob because he loved him unto salvation. That means Jacob could never be lost. That his salvation was eternally secure because it was backed by the suretyship of Jesus Christ. When did that happen? Before they were ever born. Absolutely not according to their works in any way, shape, or form. God loved one of these boys. One of these boys was in Christ. He was elected unto salvation. He hated another one of these boys. In that hatred, he passed him by. He left him to himself. When? Before the world was ever formed. That's when God loved a people, and that's when he elected a people. Now, when? When and why? Why did he love Jacob? Why did he choose Jacob? I'm going to give you three things on this. This is what the scripture says. Ephesians 1:4 says, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. You see, the elect were chosen in a man, in a person, and that before the foundation of the world, in Christ. Christ is the Father's first elect. That was the first one he chose. He says, this is my darling son. This is my elect right here. And every member of the elect, everybody God loves, and I don't understand this. This is just the way it is. They share an eternal union with Jesus Christ. Right now, if you're a believer, understand this. You have always been a part of the body of Jesus Christ. Always been one with him. You were chosen because the Father chose Christ, and it was a package deal. He got all the elect right along with him because he chose his son. That's why he chose Jacob. That's why he loved Jacob, because Jacob was in Christ. That's where all God's love is stored up. Here's the second reason. This is 1 Samuel 12:22. It says, for the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it hath pleased the Lord to make you his people. Why did he choose Jacob? Why did he love Jacob? Because he was pleased to. We could just stop there, couldn't we? It pleased the Lord to do this. This one who can do no wrong. This one, it's right, whatever he does. It pleased the Lord to choose Jacob and to love Jacob. That's all the reason you needed right there. I love what he says there. He goes, he's not going to forsake his people. Why not? Why will he never forsake his people? Because of his great namesake. Because if he did, if he turned his back on the people after making this great promise, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, you will never see death. If he was to turn his back on his people for any way, he would cease to be God. His name would be sullied. No, he won't turn his back on his people for his great namesake, that his glorified name would remain glorified. Here's what our text says, though. Why? That the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. Why did he love Jacob? Why did he choose Jacob? Why did he elect a people? That the purpose of God. What is the purpose of God? What's God's purpose, his ultimate purpose? It's very simply this. It is to glorify the Godhead in the person of the Son, Jesus Christ the Savior, through the complete salvation of his people. And for that to be accomplished, for that purpose to come about, God sovereignly had to elect the people and keep those people in Christ eternally secure. Because if you take away the sovereignty of God from salvation, if you take away election from salvation, all that ensures is that no one will be saved. Men hate election. The natural man hates the sovereignty of God in salvation. And yet, it is the one thing that is responsible for the salvation. Now, I want you to consider this for a second. Esau. God hated Esau. He passed by Esau. Somebody says, that doesn't sound real fair. Let me ask this question. If Esau would have bowed the knee to Christ, and he would have come to Christ for mercy, and he would have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, would that man have been saved? He absolutely would have been saved. And I'll give you the scripture here. It's this. Revelation 22:17. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. You can't take that too far. Any willing whosoever. Are you willing to be saved by this Christ? This one who will have all the glory for himself. It's all going to go to him. He's going to do all the work, and you will simply be an object of his power and his grace. If you are willing to be saved under those circumstances, this is for you. The call is for you. If Esau would have came, would he have been received? Absolutely, he would have. Question is, did he? No. Why? Because he was couldn't. He was born the exact same way every man is born, dead in trespasses and sins. No acts of spiritual life could be performed. He could not believe God. But here's the kicker. He didn't want to. He had absolutely no interest in Christ. He had no interest in the glory of God. He had no interest in the salvation of his soul. Absolutely no interest. And this is what happens when there is no sovereignty of God in salvation. If there is no election, this is what the natural man does. He will not come. You take away election. You take away the sovereignty of God in salvation. All it ensures is that no one will be saved. Election is not responsible for Esau's damnation. You know who's responsible for Esau's damnation? Esau. But the sovereignty of God and God's election is 100% responsible for Jacob's salvation. The only reason that man ever came to Christ, the only reason he ever believed him and believed on him, is for this reason. Because God loved him before the foundations of the world were ever built. He elected him. He was in Christ. Christ died for him. The Holy Spirit gave him life and drew him to Christ and preserved him all the way to the end of his days. That's the only reason, the love of God and the sovereignty of God and salvation. Not to be blamed, but to be gloried in. This is wonderful. This is beautiful. God has elected a people. But do we have any influence in that? No. This is something that took place before the worlds ever began. What about calling? It says, make your calling and election sure. Turn over here to 1 Corinthians 1. Look at verse 26. Paul says, for you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised, God hath chosen. That's the third time we read in these verses of scriptures, God hath chosen. And base things of the world and things which are despised, God hath chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. This thing of being called of God, called from death unto life, called from unbelief to faith in Christ. How much influence do we have in that? God hath chosen. He chooses who this call goes to. Everybody loved and everybody he elected. That's who it goes to right there. Any influence in this thing of this calling whatsoever? No. None whatsoever. So what does he mean? What does Peter mean diligently? Make your calling and election sure. He's not saying you got to earn it, because these things are outside our influence. These are things that took place before the world ever began. Then what does he mean? I give you a commentary on this. This is what something that Paul said, and it summarizes what Peter is saying here. I'll read this to you. It's 2 Corinthians 13:5. Paul says, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Now that's exactly what Peter is talking about. Peter says, diligently, make your calling and election sure. Paul tells us what that is. Examine yourselves if ye be in the faith. What is the evidence of my election? I don't have access to the Lamb's Book of Life. I can't open those golden pages and see my name written there. I cannot see that. Calling, I don't have a golden invitation sitting on my coffee table. It says, come to Christ. None of those things. How do I know? What is the evidence of my calling and my election? Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And Paul says there's only one. If you be in the faith. You see, everybody who has this God-given faith, it's always the same faith. It's the faith that the Father had in the Son, the same faith that the Son had in the Father. It's the faith of every believer has always had in Christ. It is a singular God-given faith. How can I know if I have been elected and I have been called? Make it sure, diligently. How could I possibly know that? Am I in this faith, this God-given faith? I think we should find out. Now go back to your text in 2 Peter 1. He talks about faith in the first four verses. And he has some amazing things to say. Pick up in verse 1 there. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ to them who have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now he addresses his audience here. Those who have obtained like precious faith. You know that word obtained, you know what it means? Received by divine allotment. You see, everybody who's supposed to have faith, they all have faith because it is God-given faith. They get their allotment. Everybody God loved, everybody Christ died for, everybody that the Father elected, they all have a portion of this faith. They get it by divine allotment. This faith comes from God. It can't be mustered. I can't come up with faith on my own. You can't come up with faith on your own. It could only be God-given. This like, it's all like, it's always the same faith, and it's precious. Because if a man has this faith, he has salvation. Now look at verse 2. He says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Everybody who has been given this like precious faith, you know what that's an evidence of? They have all things that pertain to life and godliness. If you have this faith, you know what that means? You are complete before the Father. Every demand he has of you has been achieved in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you lack absolutely nothing before him. All things for life and godliness have already been taken care of. It's done. It's a done deal. Nothing left for you to do. And he goes on with this. Look at verse 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Everybody who has this like precious faith, all the promises of the gospel, they are for you. They all pertain to you, and is the evidence that you have a divine nature. There is a holy man residing in you, and he is without corruption. You have no sin, because Jesus Christ has actually put away your sin. You have none before the Father. This is the implications of having this like precious faith. Do I have this faith? Look at verse 5. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, all these things, he mentions seven things here, six really, because two are combined. But these seven things, I want to say this carefully, I want all these things. First thing he talks about is virtue, growing in this grace of having an honorable character. I want to have an honorable character. Say, why? Because it's right. Because it's good. I want to be an honorable individual. I don't want to bring any shame upon my Savior's name. I don't want to bring any shame upon his gospel. A virtuous man. I want to have an honorable character. I want to grow in that grace. Second thing he talks about is knowledge. Grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to grow in that grace. Next thing he says is temperance, self-denial. I don't want to be tossed about with every lust of this flesh. I don't want to give in constantly to those lusts and live in that manner. A temperate man talks about this, patience, not always tossed about with every happening, every trial, actually waiting on the Lord. What a grace. He talks about godliness, reverence for the Lord's character, growing in that fear. I want to do that. And brotherly kindness and charity, growing in love for you, for my brethren, for my God. I want all those things, but I want to say this. There is a deeper meaning to these seven things that he gives us here. Go back up to verse 5. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith. Now you see that word add? That doesn't mean an addition. You have this, add that to it. What that actually means is furnish it, supply it. You could actually say these things that Peter lines out here, these seven things, you could say this is the stuff of faith. Now, if faith is a storehouse, a barn, what's in the storehouse? What are the supplies of faith? This list of things he gives us here, you could say this is the stuff of faith. What do I mean by that? Let's talk about it for a second. The first word he uses here is virtue. It means an honorable character. It means to be morally upright. Now, what's the truth? What is the God's honest truth as we sit here right now? The honest truth is this, that for me to be accepted by the Father, I must be a truly honorable man, truly virtuous, truly morally upright. I have to be a righteous man. I have to be a man to where the law looks me over and says, he has done absolutely nothing wrong ever. And he has always kept me, always done that which is right. That is God's standard, and he's not going to accept anybody who does not meet that standard. Where do I look for my virtue? Where does faith look for that virtue? It looks to Christ alone. I want to give you an example of this. It's one I thought of. You remember that woman with the issue of blood 12 years? Spent all her living on remedies that wouldn't work and physicians that wouldn't take away that disease. But she got near the master, and he was being thronged by that crowd, and she crawled on her hands and knees back behind him, and she touched the bottom edge of his garment. And what happened? You remember? That disease immediately left her, and his virtue entered her. He said, somebody hath touched me. I perceive that virtue has left me. That is my hope of salvation, folks. That's where I look to for my virtue. This is my hope, that there's a connection between Christ and me, this union that is so strong and it is so real, so much so that he took my sin, and my sin was taken out of me and it was put into him. And he bore that sin on the cross, the wrath of it, the shame of it, every bit of it. And he died, and when he did, he put away my sin. And as much as my sin exited me and went into him, his virtue, his righteousness went into me. And I actually have the very righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. My faith is looking for one place for virtue, and that is to Christ in him crucified alone. That's where faith looks. It looks to Christ and what he has done. Now, second word here, knowledge. Faith isn't blind, and it's not ignorant, and it's not dumb. Faith has knowledge. Faith knows some things, but they're not things. Faith knows a person. Faith knows Christ. Now, what do I mean by that? Paul said this. He said, for I know whom. Faith rests in a person whom I have believed. And I am persuaded, this is what I know about him, that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Where was Paul looking? Was he looking at a doctrine or a set of circumstances or a set of facts? And I'm thankful for doctrine. Don't misunderstand me. Christ cannot be known apart from his doctrine. But I don't look to doctrine. My faith doesn't look to doctrine. It looks to Christ. He is the one who is able. Our faith rests in a man, the man Christ Jesus. Paul would go on later to say this, that I may know what? Him. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. What is the power of his resurrection? That's the sign. It tells us this one thing. Everybody Christ died for, they've been redeemed. He actually put away the sins of his people and made them acceptable to God. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the evidence of that. He was raised again for, or because of, our justification. That I may know him. Now, with faith there is always knowledge of Christ. But faith comes in measure, and so does knowledge. But there is common knowledge. There is knowledge of Christ that every believer knows. Say, where do you get that? I thought of the thief on the cross. Remember that thief who was crucified next to the master? I don't know, maybe this is the case, but he seems to be the man in Scripture that was converted the shortest amount of time before he was brought into glory. died. What did that man know? Because it seems like he knew Christ, at least in a spiritual sense, a very short amount of time before he died. What did that man know? I'm going to give you four things he knew, and every believer knows this. Number one, he knew that that one being crucified next to him was God, was Lord, and was King. Here's what he said from the cross. Speaking to the other malefactor, he looked at him and said, "Don't you fear God?" Recognizing we are in the same condemnation. This man, this one who is being crucified next to us, is God. There is a God. There is a creator. There is one who made all this. There is a supreme being, and I know exactly who he is. His name is Jesus of Nazareth. And that thief knew that. This is God Almighty. And later he would say, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." You see, you're a king. This is Lord and King. This is the sovereign. This is the one that we are all responsible and accountable to. This is the one who holds my salvation in his hands and is completely and utterly up to him. He's the Lord. He is God and he is King. Everybody who the Lord has saved know that he is in fact the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He's the sovereign of the universe. You know what else that thief knew? He knew that he was a sinner. He said this, speaking to the other malefactor, he said, "And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds." Now, he's talking in a temporal sense there as well. He's saying, we're dying on these crosses. We're getting exactly what we deserve. We committed the crimes. The punishment always fits the crime. But he's talking about spiritual things as well. Just a minute, just a little time after this time, we're going to stand before God in judgment, and he's going to render a judgment. And if he sends us to hell, you know what he is? He's right, and he's just, and he's fair. We indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. Whatever God does with us is right, because we have sinned against God. And everybody who knows Christ knows that. My sin is against him. I'm a sinner against him, and he doesn't owe me a thing. How did he know that, though? How did he know that he was a sinner before God? Did he come to some natural understanding of what he was? No. He said this about Christ. He said, "But this man hath done nothing amiss." He knew something of the righteousness and the holiness and the infallibility of Jesus Christ. And every believer knows that he's righteous and he's holy and he is separate from sinners. He is the spotless lamb, but it's only in standing in the light of his countenance, in seeing him for who he is, that's when we see what we are. Now, man doesn't come to a natural understanding of his sinfulness before God. He comes from getting a glimpse of Christ. You see him and his righteousness and his holiness, and seeing that's his standard. That is God's standard, is perfect righteousness. All we can do is say this: "Woe unto me, I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amongst a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts," and take our place in the dust. Finally, this, he knew that if the Lord Jesus Christ just willed his salvation, he would be saved. "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And I'm not so sure he had a good understanding of the means the Lord would use that. And I don't think this man could talk very intelligently about imputation and things like that. All this man knew was this: this is God sitting next to me here. And all he has to do is will my salvation. And if he wills it, it will be. This man can't fail. You know that? I know that. I know that about this man, Jesus Christ. If he wills my salvation, saved I must be, because this man can't fail. He is impossible. It is impossible for him to fail. That's knowledge. Faith is always accompanied by knowledge. The third word is this: it's temperance. It speaks of self-denial. Now, faith is one side of a two-sided coin. I'm going to read you this. This is Hebrews 6, verse 1. It says, "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works." That's one side of the coin. "And faith toward God." That's the other side of the coin. Wherever there is faith toward God, there is this as well. Repentance from dead works. Now the word is temperance, self-denial. What is the natural inclination of man? The natural inclination of man is this, is try to justify myself by my works before God. You know what? I deny that. I deny that in any way, shape, or form. I don't want anything to do with God judging me based on my works. I repent of those dead works. Wherever there is true faith toward God, there is repentance from dead works. Everything I've done, it hasn't amounted to a hill of beans. There's nothing I've done that can stand before God. Nothing I've done. He can look at me and say, yes, that is in fact good. I'll receive you. Absolutely nothing. I repent of all those dead works. I've got one hope, and it is in Christ alone. I deny all that that I used to believe and I used to think. My only hope is that I will be brought into the presence of the Father in Jesus Christ, and when he looks at me, he will see nothing but his darling son. My works completely and utterly put away and excluded. That's it. Wherever there's faith, there's repentance from dead works, self-denial. Fourth word is this, it's patience. Patience. Just waiting on the Lord. And this is the activity of faith. Faith is not idle. Faith is very active, but this is what faith does. It rests and it trusts Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to have you look at a scripture here. Turn over to Luke 21. This is a blessing to me to read. You may enjoy it. Look at verse 10 of Luke 21. The Lord is speaking about things to come. Verse 10, he says, "Then said he unto them, Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. But before all these, they shall lay their hands on you, and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues, and into their prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my namesake. And it shall turn to you for a testimony." They're going to ask you about these things. You're going to have to say some things. "Settle it therefore in your hearts not to meditate before what you shall answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. And ye shall be betrayed both by parents and brethren, kinsfolks and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake." But look at this promise. "But there shall not an hair of your head perish." Even though all this is going to go on, all these trials and tribulations I'm telling you all about, not a hair of your head is going to perish, not eternally. Look at verse 19. "In your patience possess ye your souls." He's telling these men, all these terrible things are going to happen to you, but not one hair of your head eternally is going to perish. And you know what they did? They believed him. "In your patience possess ye your souls." They simply patiently waited on the Lord, and they believed what he said. And you know what? Everybody's got this God-given faith. We believe what he says. Now, I believe in him. I believe that Jesus Christ is exactly who he says he is in this book. He is God himself, the sovereign of the universe, the omniscient one, the omnipotent one, that one who cannot fail. He is exactly who he says he is in this book. I believe that. I believe in him. And I believe on him. My hope of salvation rests in him and what he has done. I am clinging to a man, the man Christ Jesus. But I believe him. I believe everything he has said in this book. You believe it perfectly? No. I believe, help thou my unbelief. But I believe what he says in this book. And these precious promises, I take these home. This is my favorite one, though. We're talking about a promise. I believe this. Everybody who has this God-given faith believes this. 1 Timothy 1:15, this is a faithful saying. You can rely on this. You can hang your hat on this. "And worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." Now, that is a promise I take home. I believe that. I rest in that. I need nothing else than that promise right there. This man, Christ Jesus, who cannot fail, just told me that he is the Savior of sinful men. I am a sinful man. Therefore, I conclude, this man saved me. And you know what? I rest and I trust in that right there. I need absolutely nothing else. I find all my hope and my comfort in that. I can patiently wait right there on the Lord because of what he said, that he is the Savior of sinners. That means the deal is done and there's nothing left for me to do, and it's all good news for me. Next word is godliness. That word is generally translated holiness. What does false religion say? You got to grow in it. Get holier. Get better all the time. Where does a believer look for his holiness? My sanctification. Where am I going to find full, true sanctification that can stand before God? Hebrews 2:11. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. There is one place I look for my holiness and my sanctification. Look for Christ alone. My hope is that I have such a tight-knit relationship with him. That union is so real that as he is, so am I right now in this world. That's where we look for holiness. Everybody who has this God-given, like, precious faith, they look to Christ for their holiness. And finally this. This sixth phrase talks about brotherly kindness and charity, which is love. Now, I want to grow in this grace. I very much do. But hear me out on this. What is brotherly kindness? It is kindness that is shown for a reason that is outside of the object. Now, I'm commanded to love you, my brethren, and you are commanded to love me. Why should I do that? Because you are my brother. That's the reason. The reason is not found in you. And here's the thing, if you want to love me, and you go start digging deep enough, for every reason you find to love me, you'll find three not to. And it's the same with you. The reason for love is found outside the object. Love him because he's your brother in Christ. That's why you should do it. Everybody who has this God-given faith, they know this. I have the love of God. I believe that. He told me I do. But he didn't show me that love because of some reason in me. He didn't find something lovable about me to show that love. He found the reason outside of me. He found it in himself. The Father loved me, not because there was anything naturally lovable about me, because of who I was in. That's who the elect are in. It's in Christ. All the Father's love is in Christ. When he loved Christ, he loved us. Christ. Not that there was anything lovable about me. All we ever do is rebel against him. To this very day. And at the end of the day, his love for us does not move. Where is it found? It's outside of us. He finds it in himself. When a man loves his wife, he is loving himself. When Christ loves his church, he is loving himself. He can't show himself love without loving the elect just as well. Everybody who has this God-given faith knows this. That love we have of God, where salvation began and where it ends, wasn't for a reason in us. He found the reason in himself. What a glorious thought. If the reason is not in me, if he finds the reason in himself, that means I can't send this away. What I do, it's not going to reject or get his love away from me. I will always have his love because he finds the reason outside of me. He finds it in himself. Now, go back to your text, look at verse 9. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off and hath forgotten that he is purged from his old sins. Now, this is talking about a believer. We know that because he says, he's been purged of his old sins. And this is man, something you would call spiritually nearsighted. He can't see it far off. He's looking close. What happens when we take our eyes off Christ and we start looking in ourselves for some evidence of salvation, for some hope and some peace. You lose all assurance. You lose all assurance, as we rightly should, because we've taken our eyes off of the object of salvation, and we put it where it's not, right here in ourselves. And we forget that we've been purged of our old sins. If you want to have no assurance, you want to find no comfort, no peace, look inside here for all these things. Look inside here for evidence of salvation, for hope of salvation. If you want to be discouraged, this is where you look. That's nearsightedness right here. You look afar off. And this is my point in saying this. Faith has absolutely nothing to do with what you think about yourself. Absolutely nothing to do. Faith has everything to do with what you think about Christ. We find all these things in salvation. We look to one man for these things. We look to him, those who have this God-given faith. That's where that faith looks. Now, I'll wrap this up. Peter said this. He said, "Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure." Now, how do I do that? Do I have this like precious faith? And it's real simple. This faith looks to the Lord Jesus Christ for everything in salvation, and it's got nowhere else to look. And if you are in that boat, I want you to recognize something. That is the very evidence that you are elect of God. You have been called of God, and your salvation is eternally secure. You belong to him. Safest place you could possibly be. I'm going to leave you there. It's been a blessing being with you this morning.
Have a word of prayer. Our blessed Lord God Almighty, our kind Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word that we've just heard proclaimed to us. Thank you for these blessed truths. Lord, thank you for the faith that you give your people. We ask that you cause it to grow. Those things of faith that we just heard about, Lord, cause increase in us. We ask that you would bless our time together today, that you would bless our fellowship, allow us to gather here once more this evening, hear your word again. We ask that thy will be done for Christ's sake. Amen. Let's all stand and we'll sing hymn number 228. 228. At the end, you go up there.
My heart is leaning.
blessed word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through his blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me. My great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, for me his life he gave. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
We'll meet again this evening at 6, Lord willing. You're dismissed.